Yo, Adam Saxon with Guy in a Cube, and in this video, we're gonna go inside my mind to look at how I went about optimizing some Power Query to help with performance and resource usage. Let's do this. If you're finding us for the first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date with all the videos from both Patrick and myself. All right, this one, I'm so excited. I need to do some setup first before we get into this. So Patrick and I ended up jumping on a call with a customer. Shout out to Chad who worked with us on this. We had like an hour and a half working session and we just went through and tried it. So the challenge here, you know what? Enough all this talking. Let's head over to my machine and let me show you what the challenge was. All right, I mentioned Power Query. This is going to be in the context of data flows. I can do the same thing in Power BI Desktop. All the steps are the same, the concepts are the same. But in this case, we were actually troubleshooting some data flows related performance problems. So the challenge here, if we go to schedule refresh or we go to refresh history, you can see here that my data flow is taking about 2 minutes, minute 46, 2 minutes. In Chad's case, it was around the 4 to 5 minute mark for a normal refresh, but occasionally they would see it go about 40 minutes to refresh one. It's the same thing, nothing changed. We're like, come on, what's going on? And so when we looked, and this is what I love about data flows, if we download the given refresh history for a given item, let's go look. We'll see a couple things here, start time, end time. In all of our workings here, we're gonna focus on three things. The commit size, so this is the amount of memory that ended up going in what's called a container. So when we're refreshing data flows, there are mashup containers that end up doing the work for Power Query, and those have memory consumption associated with it. So in this case, you can see this is about 2.3 gigs of memory for this given data flow. And it took the processor, so this is CPU time, more time than the duration, and that's because if it's spread out across a couple of processors. And so this took a long time to do. But in the case of the 40 minute outlier, what we saw was wait time. The actual data flow still took about 4 to 5 minutes. The rest of the time was this wait. So what the heck is the wait? And that's what we need to optimize, right? Is we need to avoid the wait. We're waiting on an available container inside of Power BI to go process the data flow. There's only a set number of containers that are available for premium capacity. And they were all chewed up with the amount of data flows that were going in and out of this given capacity. You've got two options in that case. One is you could potentially scale up the capacity, which will give you more container availability. Obviously that's a hard sell, right? It involves money, there's cost, approvals, it's hard. The other thing we did, and this is what I told Chad, I was like, look, let's just jump on a call and let's actually see what we can do from a Power Query side to make it more efficient. If we can make it take less memory, if we can make it go faster, then things are going in and out more quickly. And so we don't have this contention on the container. So that was the goal. Let's go back and actually see what we had to do. Let's go into the data flow itself. The other thing I like about this scenario, it's a great example of what business analysts have to do in a given day to day. You may not have access to the data source and you're just trying to get things done. Over time, this data flow probably will get a little messy, right? You'll start out at point A and then as you do things, it'll go to point B. It just gets a little more overloaded over time. As we look at this, let's pay attention to a couple things. One is how long it took, the duration, the running. The other thing we want to look at is memory, and then also CPU is interesting as well. And you can see here, this is very high CPU, and we can also see that the memory itself is going to get up to around 2 gigs. Or a little over or a little under, depending on what it shows. Actually came up pretty quick, took about 30 seconds or so. So let's look at what it is. So we've got the folding indicators here. A lot of this stuff is not folding. I already see some things that are suspect. And if we go jump into advanced M here, I know this is gonna be scary, but this is what I wanted to go look at to see if we could optimize. This looks really scary, but let's break this down. The things that are red flags for me were these merged queries. And there's two of them here, one on line 3, one on line 6. Merge queries, right off the bat, that's triggering me a little bit. The other thing that's triggering me here is we have a native query. So we've actually got this query on line 2, the select product key, like we're defining the SQL statement that's going there. Right away, that's gonna break query folding. In this case, my example, it's using Azure SQL Database. In the example that we were using, I believe it was on-premise Hadoop. And so they were just issuing a select statement to get what they want. So first off, why were they doing native query? Because my first question is, can we avoid the native query first off? Like, how do we do this so we can maybe fold back to the source? And the answer was, in order to actually get like a view or a certain way that accommodates what we're looking for, it's going to take like 6 months to go through that process. We don't have that kind of time. The other thing too is that the thing that we want to do that triggers this whole thing isn't even in Hadoop. So we need to do it externally to that, which is where these merges come in. You may relate to that in terms of going down this native query path. And so these are the challenges we have from a business perspective. Now, what we're doing with these merge columns, you'll see here, we've got promotion and then we've got currency. So let me get out of the advanced editor and you'll see that I've got these promotion and currency queries that aren't being loaded. And all they are these external Excel files. We've got that native query that's pulling in, just doing a select over the whole table. And we're using these Excel files to actually filter down the end data result of the data flow. These are the where clauses. So where currency key are 19, 98, and 100, those are the rows I want to keep. And then promotion key, same thing. If we come back in here, we're doing a merge. So we're only keeping the rows that match. Merges are expensive. They're going to be costly. It causes a lot of churn on the Power Query side. My whole goal here is how do we get rid of the merges? So I'm like, okay, they're using this as a where predicate. We already have the query that's pulling in the Excel. So I've got a list of numbers. In my head, I'm thinking, can I get this into the actual SQL query itself? In the SQL query, could I put where promotion key is in this set of numbers? So that's a T-SQL type reference. Chad and his team, they knew how to write SQL. So we were on the same page, like, oh, that sounds great. So how do we do that? This is where the magic came in. So what I want to do is I need this promotion key, right? I want a list so I can put in the where clause here and go from there. So let's go look at promotion. So again, this is a list of numbers, right? It's a table. So what I'm thinking here is there's a function out there called text.combine. So let's look for that. You can use the internet search engine of your choice. I'm just searching for Power Query text.combine. And so when we look at this, what can I do? I need to pass in a list of text values, and then I can optionally add a separator. And it even gives you a nice little example here where you can add the separators. Okay, that's cool. So what I need to do is I need to convert this. This is a table, right? I need it as a list. Also, this is listed as a number. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to get rid of this change column item. So now it's not a number. I'm just going to change it to text. You may not have to do this. I'm going to go to transform. And then there's a nice little thing here that says convert to list. Damn, but this isn't the format that I need. I need a comma separated list of items. Cause when I go into the where clause, the in statement needs to be number, comma, number, comma, number. So how do I get that kind of format? Let's go in advanced editor. This is just me tinkering, right? I'm trying things. Let's see if we can get this to work. When I was going through this on the call, I had no idea if this would actually work, but I'm trying this. Maybe it'll fail. We'll try something else. Patrick was right there with me. He was thinking the same thing. And actually this became a race competition between Patrick and I. We were both on our machines trying to replicate this. And so I was trying it on my end. Patrick was trying it on his end first. Spoilers, I won. It's already in list format. So what I'm going to do here is text.combine. The tooltips didn't come up here. If you're in Power BI Desktop, it'll actually give you the IntelliSense that tells you what it is. But if we go back and look at our documentation, the first parameter here is the list itself. In this case, the list is going to be the reference of this name on the left side. And then we can add the separators just like that. After each item in that list, I want to add comma space and then just go through the list. Now, what I need to do is change the in statement to be the last item in my list of function calls. Hit okay. Bam. That's exactly what I want. And at that point, I told Patrick, I got it. And we got really excited. This could work. You'll notice here that internet sales is broke at this point. That's okay. We're going to do the same exact thing for currency. Go to transform. We can go to convert to list. Go to the advanced editor again. And this is where you actually have to convert it to text first. Let's back up. And this is what I mean by like trial and error, just trying things. Sometimes you're going to hit an error because maybe this is the first time you've done something and this is how you learn it. So let's change it to text and then we'll convert it to a list. Then we will modify. Same thing we did before. Bam. Now we've got both of our lists here. Ignore the warning. Internet sales is still busted, but now we're going to come in and we're just going to modify this part of it. So again, what I want to do is get these as a where clause in the select. So I'm taking this merge, which they used as a where. I'm just going to insert it into this query statement. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to get a reference to those other queries. This part's probably just not necessary, but I'm doing it just for readability's sake. So I'm adding currency list and then I've got promotion list. So these are my my references that I'll use in my where clause. Remember to add the commas. And then let's just add the where. So this is the first part. I'm adding the promotion key. That is the column. And that's where this list is going off of. So I'm saying where promotion key is in this list, which is a comma separated number list. And then we're just going to inject that into the T-SQL statement. Now what I can do here is these two lines, bam, they're gone, because now I've injected it into the where clause itself. So now we need to do the currency list. And then I said, and currency key in, and then the currency list, which is comma separated numbers. Now what I can do is I can get rid of those two lines. The merges are gone. So now I just need to fix up the references here. So this was referencing the step removed columns before. So now that's gone. So let's just change it to source, because that's the previous step. And then the next item, ideally you could combine these, but for the case of this, I'm just moving along. That's not what's going to give me a big boost to performance. So now we're referencing the step previously, and then the final step is still the same from what we did. Let's hit okay, and let's see what this change actually does. This is the bananas part. Because we're injecting into the T-SQL statement, we're going to have to disable privacy levels. Be very careful on this and be mindful about what sources you're hitting, and do you trust those sources? There's some documentation about what privacy levels are. In this case, I'm going to disable the privacy levels. I trust those two sources. And now let's see what happens. So here we go. Memory. Whew. 7 seconds. That was fast. So we got everything we needed. We converted everything. Everything's there. So let's actually save it and let's refresh and compare what we got. So that's refreshing now. That was fast. Let's go schedule refresh. Let's go refresh history. Look at that. 1:40, 2 minutes before. Now it's 11 seconds. I'm going to grab these two refresh histories and mock it up into an Excel file so we can compare real quick. Through the magic of editing, we'll just cut ahead to the final product. All right, look at this. So bytes process is the same. The commit size, how much memory are we using in those containers? Went from 2 gig to 64 meg. That's insane. That's such a huge reduction because of those merges. And then our processor time, the CPU burn on this went from 1:50 down to 9 seconds. That is insane. Amazing. We're reducing resource contention as part of this. We cleaned it up, made it more efficient, getting those merges out of there, being a little creative with how we're going about doing it. And that's going to free some things up over time. Again, they had a lot of different data flows. So this was a pattern that they could now go back to those other ones and kind of do similar things to try and free up that resource contention to avoid those long waits. All right, I want to hand this over to you. What do you think? Did this help you understand like how we actually go about optimizing something in Power Query? This could be desktop, data flows, whatever. Let me know in the comments below what you think, or if there's other things that you do that just help give you that extra boost. If you like this video, be sure to hit that big thumbs up button. Smash it if you so desire. If it's your first time here, hit that subscribe button. And as always, from both Patrick and myself, thank you so much for watching. Keep being awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.